we're talking about North Korea, runner-up for best Korea the last 40 years. They're gonna get right on that feeding their citizens thing just as soon as they figure out intercontinental ballistic missiles that can reach the East Coast. As you may have heard, US-North Korean relations have gone south. It almost seems like pundits are longing for the days when we were casually threatening to nuke each other and comparing button sizes. But now we're walking out of meetings. This is serious. Today we're not focusing on the Vietnam meeting, but rather an interesting moral question that's dogging this administration right now. How far should the United States go in sanctioning a country? Now, we focused recently on the United States bumping up sanctions on Iran and Venezuela, but in North Korea, there's a different story. Specifically, sanctions or saving lives. In an accusation that seldom gets thrown around in Washington, one of our policies might have been too effective.
The U.S., Japan, and South Korea have agreed to apply, quote, maximum pressure after North Korea's intercontinental ballistic missile test.
Maximum pressure? There's really no place to go from there. Wait, maximum pressure didn't work? How about ludicrous pressure? This is the problem, though, because after the Vietnam conversation fell apart, you now have two parties debating. First, we have John Bolton, and you'll never guess what his opinion is on sanctioning North Korea. Increase the sanctions! Yeah, wow, who saw that one coming? This introduces the first laughing so hard I'm crying sort of problem. You see, the United States has been sanctioning North Korea so long and so intensely, we're actually running out of things to not buy. Already, this maximum pressure campaign that Trump's engaging in is like continuing to boycott the 7-Eleven by saying, guess what? I'm not gonna take a penny or leave a penny either. Haha! I mean, when you break down what sanctions he just added, the new devastating sanctions target illicit ship-to-ship transfers of refined fuel and coal that have allowed North Korea to mitigate the pain from those earlier sanctions. So essentially, the new sanctions are enforcing the previous sanctions. I mean, we're talking about a country with a population size similar to Australia that exports $1.74 billion worth of goods. Jeff Bezos tips that much when he's had bad service. Seriously, what are we not gonna buy? Well, Trump, it appears as though they've cornered the coal briquette market, so maybe we cancel the next White House barbecue. When most people talk about sanctioning North Korea, China plays a major part in the conversation.
Not present, the nation which will probably be most affected by the new sanctions, China. But it appears there was some coordination before this move was taken.
I mean, if you look at their import-export data, it's clear to see that the North Korean economy, yet another thing made in China. Way back in early 2018, the United States was coordinating with China in order to really put the squeeze on North Korea. Sure, the occasional petroleum order would slip across the border, but it was like a parent sneaking a little dinner to the kid who they just grounded. Unfortunately, since that period of coordination, something has changed. Something that would give China quite a bit more sympathy for a country that the United States is trying to crush with trade restrictions. If you catch my drift. Basically, China, North Korea's lifeline, is saying, oh geez guys, we'd really love to help you, but we're really bogged down by all this tariff paperwork right now. If you could find a way to get this paperwork to disappear, we could probably make something happen. Because China's off the table, America has been pushed into the dark end of the moral gray area, preventing companies and organizations from doing business with North Korea. And what companies and organizations do business with North Korea?
Washington's point man on North Korea, Stephen Biegun, arrived here in Seoul on Wednesday to hold talks with his South Korean counterpart. But upon his arrival, he surprised many by announcing that the U.S. would be re-evaluating their policies to support aid efforts into North Korea.
Yeah, for a while there, America was pulling a Maduro and stopping some aid at the North Korean border, because it would interfere with sanctions. As Foreign Policy reported, United States Secretary of State Mike Pompeo decided in the summer to sharply limit the amount of aid allowed into North Korea. And yeah, it's hard to spin this one, especially because we're not talking about healing crystals here. More like surgical equipment for hospitals, supplies for fighting tuberculosis and malaria, and stainless steel milk containers for orphanages? Really? We're bringing orphans into this? As though we couldn't be any more of a Disney villain. I mean, it's really never a good sign when the United Nations looks at North Korea and then looks at you and says, yeah, you really have to stop these human rights violations. You know, you got a little too far on this one. And that's exactly what happened when in late January we caved to diplomatic pressure and removed those sanctions. This was described as the move that marked the first significant step in months by the Trump administration to relax its maximum pressure campaign on Pyongyang. And all this brings us back to the question that we're dealing with today. How far is too far in pushing to denuclearize North Korea or bring about some sort of systemic reform? Now, I know some in the comments will take the nuanced opinion of kill all North Koreans or America is a terrorist imperialist country, but this really is a question that our best and brightest, well, got replaced by these guys who are working on that issue right now. It's especially urgent because...
Breaking news. New satellite images apparently show that North Korea has begun rebuilding key missile facilities. And this, of course, is taking place after talks collapsed between President Trump and Kim Jong-un.
Man, they didn't even have the courtesy to wait like 5 minutes. I mean, at least make it seem like you thought this had a chance. So let's head back to our two foreign policy advisors, because while Bolton and Pompeo both want maximum pressure, Bolton's maximum pressure is a little more maximum pressure. His sanction philosophy is two-pronged. First, we need to keep increasing sanctions until we get a deal. Already right there, a clear question is raised. If we already don't buy things from them and our allies don't buy things from them, how do we increase sanctions? He would want to get back to targeting various countries and businesses that have been found evading military and financial restrictions. Although critics look at this and say, well, okay, but because more than 90% of their economy is China, we're going to essentially open up a second front in the trade war by sanctioning Chinese companies again for another reason, when we're already really close to coming to a trade agreement, according to the newspapers. The other thing Bolton is completely opposed to is compromise. Here's a clip of him talking about the recent failed summit in Vietnam.
I don't agree at all that it was a failed summit. I think the obligation of the President of the United States is to defend and advance American national security interest. And I think he did that by rejecting a bad deal and by trying again to persuade Kim Jong-un to take the big deal that really could make a difference for North Korea.
Okay, not failed. We'll just call it this generation's Vietnam quagmire. Point is, he wants to see no sanctions reductions until we have a completely denuclearized Korea. So I wouldn't expect to see any North Korean gold briquettes hitting your Albertsons anytime soon. I will just leave that graphic up there for a second because it took me a really long time to make it. This is a new approach because traditionally administrations have taken a more Pompeo, step-by-step approach to North Korea. And hawks such as Bolton have fiercely opposed this step-by-step process in favor of maintaining maximum pressure. Yeah, when Pompeo switched jobs from CIA director to Secretary of State, he seemed to have really found his calling in diplomacy. Because your boy loves to talk. A lot. 4 days ago, he came out and said he's hopeful for new North Korean talks after Hanoi. And who knows, they can chat over burgers. America provides the food, and they provide the coal briquettes.
We didn't get there. And so I am hopeful, although I have no commitment yet, that we will be back at it, that I'll have a team in Pyongyang in the next couple weeks, continuing to work to find those places where there's a shared interest.
He'd be more in support of calling up Kim and getting North Korea to dismantle its plutonium and uranium enrichment facilities in exchange for corresponding measures by the United States. The problem is, we've been doing this strategy since the 90s, and it's gotten us to the point where North Korea has a nuclear weapon and the ability to hit the United States with a missile. So, as far as goals achieved goes, I'm putting this one in the complete failure category. It might still be more plausible as an option though, because for John Bolton's plan to work, we're gonna have to just royally destroy North Korea, to the point where there's a fear of destabilization. Which, man, this moral gray area is going to get uncomfortably dark soon. If that famine couldn't do it, oh boy.
Is it a requirement that Kim Jong-un agree to give away those weapons before you give any kind of concession?
I think that's right. I think we're looking at the Libya model of 2003-2004.
Yeah, Kim, we're going to stick to the Libyan model of negotiation. Basically, their leader gave up his nuclear arsenal and program in exchange for economic integration with the West. There was no step-by-step, it just happened in one swoop. And you know what? Ended up great for both parties.
Reports from Libya that Muammar Gaddafi, the leader of Libya for more than 40 years, has been killed by rebel forces.
Okay, ended up great for one party. Yeah, a few years later, the United States and its European allies began a military action against Libya in 2011, and everybody watched at once and said, well, if he had a nuke. So again, we're gonna really have to wreck North Korea for them to take the same deal Libya did. Or we can continue to squabble for small victories that, if history has proven anything, tend to be temporary. If I wanted to sum this episode in one graphic, I'd put up two headlines next to each other. Can you spot the difference between these two reactions to the Hanoi summit? Pompeo excited for more talks after the Hanoi summit and Bolton looking at ramping up North Korea's sanctions. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, non-partisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.